Hi guys, today's topic is about unit economics. So we're going to discover what they are, why they are important, and why this is something that you're going to need when you're going to raise capital. So here we go. Unit economics basically are a summary, or even if you want, some financial ratios out of your current company's performance, right? And there are some very important items that you should know and you should track over time. If you're not doing that, I would recommend you to start right away. And the unit economics are usually intrinsically specific to the type of business model you have, right? But there are some common patterns that I'm going to try to outline today to give you an idea of how to start and where to start. First of all, let me give you a little bit of background on how you should think in terms of the revenues and the performance of your business, right? So nowadays, the key to build a sustainable business that is going to last forever, that allows you to keep on reinvesting in the growth of the business, you should focus on recurring revenues, right? So I'm not saying that you should have a SaaS model with subscription. That is one type of recurring revenues. There are all sort of types, right? It can be annual license, it can be SaaS, it can even be a one-time purchase, as long as you are able to get those people to come back regularly to your platform one way or the other, right? Or back to your business. So what is important is that, first of all, you know how much of your revenues can be considered recurring, because this is something that VCs look for, and they want to know that your business is able to keep on generating a minimum amount of recurring revenues on a monthly basis before considering you for investments, right? So this is pretty intuitive. They want to know that even if you would stop investing today in your business, you will still have a certain level of recurring revenues that you can manage. And this, of course, lowers the risk of your proposition, right? It's much different going there saying that you have 50,000 euro in revenues last month compared to saying I have 50,000 euros in revenues recurring from last month, because it means that with a good chance of assuming different kind of unit economics that I'm going to explain to you, that 50K is going to also be replicated this month, right? So it lowers a lot the risk and increases the budget you have available for reinvesting in the growth of the company. So why unit economics matter? Well, it's quite simple, because if we just focus on profit and other, let's say, general metrics of profitability, most startups do not have positive metrics. It's very simple. And as I said in one of my previous videos, profit at startup level and till the company reaches a point where the growth is not worth the investment, to that point, profit is an option, meaning that it would be silly, and that's also what every investor knows, it would be silly to focus on a small profit today when you can sacrifice that, reinvest, and make a bigger profit tomorrow. In other terms, the cost of opportunity of making a profit today is higher than the profit that you would make. Assuming that you have some level of recurring revenues, and assuming that this is what you're focusing on and you want to track, first of all, you should know of the total revenues, how much of that on a monthly basis, quarterly basis, whatever it works for you, is recurring, right? If we have 50,000 euro of revenues last month, but only 10 is recurring, that's the kind of MRR, it's called monthly recurring revenues, that investors want to know and want to hear about, because it can be that the 40 is one time good shot, right? They want to know what is the sustainable revenues that your companies can count upon. So first of all, you need to know what's that percentage of the total. Second thing you should know about your recurring revenues is how recurring they are, meaning that if a customer comes in, right, you should know how long she's gonna stay with your company, which is also part of calculating the lifetime value of a customer, as I'm gonna explain to you in a bit. But in a nutshell, if you have a SaaS model, then your customer comes in and stays only 6 months, it means that every 6 months you have to rebuild the revenues that you got in with that customer. That's the intuition behind that. So you should think in terms of how long is a customer gonna bring in revenues before you have to regenerate that sort of revenues just to get to the same level, right? That's how you should think about that. The how long a customer stays with you can also be translated into how many times does the customer purchase in a certain time frame, right? If you have a marketplace kind of business model, then you want to know on average, at least, how many purchases will that customer do in a year time, for instance, and probably the average transaction value for those purchases, right? That helps you to tell you, okay, every time I acquire a customer, then that one is gonna generate over a period of 12 months, X level of revenues. It can even be that this one customer has an impact on the following years, which is, you know, it's one of the likely scenarios. But of course, the probability of that is, you know, on the total, it's lower. So there is a way to make this calculation simpler. On one hand, I would say approximate this calculation, but on the other, also make it still very simple and not too far from the reality, right? And this is called the churn rate. What's the churn rate? The churn rate is, in a nutshell, how much of your recurring revenues will drop out, will stop coming in from one period to the other. So if you have 50,000 euro today and the next month of that batch of revenues, without accounting for the new ones, you have 40,000 euro, it means that 10,000 euro churned, drop out, you lost revenues, right? Which implies that 50,000 euro of the last month, without considering for the new ones coming in, will disappear in 5 months, right? I think this is pretty intuitive. How do you calculate the churn rate? Well, the churn rate is the 50,000 euro the last month as the denominator, and the numerator being the revenues that churn. So we have 10 divided by 10,000 divided by 50,000, meaning that we have a churn rate of 20%, right? We're not gonna get into the topic of if 20% is good or high, but what's important is that you're saying every month the revenues that the previous period, let's say on a monthly basis, 20% of that will not come in. So the churn rate is a very, very useful way to know how much your new revenue should come in order to at least compensate the loss, first of all, but possibly increase that. Of course, it goes by itself that the lower the churn rate, the better for everybody. Going back to the previous case of when you have, like, I don't know, a kind of marketplace where you assume a sort of number of transactions per customer over a period of 12 months, so 1 year. So how do you account for the fact that some of these guys will also make similar type of purchases, or at least more purchases in the coming years? Well, the churn rate is a good way to make that, right? So it's, you can calculate the revenues of this year, right? The turnover, the total of the older customers you had, and then you can assume that a certain number of these revenues will churn, meaning that, let's say, 50% of the customer, or the revenues from the customers you acquired last year, will not repeat any purchase in the year after. This is very similar to what we said before on a monthly basis, but when it comes to companies that do not track their profitability, the performance on a month to month, because they are not a SaaS model, so there's not a recurring charging every month, but it's more like it can happen anytime during the year, but we know what's the average of transactions that happen during a certain year. Well, then we take that time frame of 12 months as our unit of temporal unit, and we use that to estimate how much of these will be replicated in the future without, again, new revenues coming in. So in a nutshell, the churn rate is the percentage of the revenues you generated over the last period of analysis that will churn again, so drop out in the next one, right? And it's a very good way to assume that a certain part of what you created already will fade away over time. Of course, the lower it is, the better. So another very important metric or unit economic that you should know regards the cost side, right? In the startup community, it's called the CAC, the CAC, which means the customer acquisition cost, right? And the general rule is that the cost of acquisition of a customer should be lower than the lifetime value of the same customer, right? So let me start from the CAC. So that is calculated accounting for, you know, any direct cost of acquiring that customer. It can be paid ads, it can be whatever, but also it can be a certain percentage of the time of a person dedicated to that task, right? Or a certain level of other variable cost imply with acquiring that customer, and that varies greatly. So usually recommendation is to take, the revenues you did in a certain time frame, say 1 month, and then you say, okay, how much to generate these revenues, how much we spent in terms of variable costs, in terms of other part, even fixed costs that went into generating those revenues. And then you say, okay, you take the number of customers, so total cost divided by the total cost attributed to those revenues divided by the number of customers, then you get the average customer acquisition cost. So this metric should be lower to have a sustainable business than the lifetime value of a customer, meaning that on average, how much revenues does that customer brings in over the lifetime, right? And this is also calculated based on the churn of that customer or how long it stays. So if we have a customer that on average stays for 6 months, then it drops, and then it's not likely that it's gonna come back again for another 6 months in the future. The lifetime value is simply the monthly cost times 6. So if your CAC is lower than that, then you have a business. If not, then you're losing money. Just to wrap it up, I just want to share some insights into the way we think about business models and the way investors look into business models, because whenever you're gonna present them a proposition, they're gonna try to break it down into the unit economics, right? So the key pieces of information that they wanna see to understand that your business is viable. The aggregated revenues, cost, burn rate, whatever, that could say that, you're losing money, it's in negative, whatever, but as long as the unit economics are positive, then you are a viable investment proposition. And that's what they wanna see. They wanna see that what you're doing, regardless of the total, so what you're doing per customer is profitable. And that's the key of behind a lot of successful deals out there. Again, as I said in the previous video, the burn rate is an option, like the profit, and therefore it's fine that these figures are negative as long as your unit economics are profitable. So I hope this is clear. I hope you have a good understanding of the principle behind the way you should think about your business model and the tracking of your performance. And based on that, I will see you in the next video.